York City Historical Association, Lynches Lake Historical Association.
No, it's not an association.
Society.
And museum. And museum. You're quite welcome.
Presented tonight, I'm Kent Daniels, and I'm Jimmy Daniels. We're here on behalf, and because of the Dartmoor Foundation, who is primary sponsor for this event. Also, we're part of the Lake City Creative Alliance, and we thank Continuum and you and the members of the Historical Society for your sponsorship. Thank you very much, and thanks for coming as we talk about the events of 1958. I'm particularly excited about tonight because I graduated in 1959, so 1958 for me was my junior year and my senior year. And I gotta admit, I don't remember a lot of this stuff. But let's stroll down memory lane tonight. 1958, Willie Cook.
We still got Willie.
Still a man.
Willie Cook ceased to be after his term of office. This is his last year.
Last year.
Last year.
And we'll also find out the fate of Louis Cook, Ed Bowen, C.J. Evans, George Tonic, Heels Blackwood, and Boyd Snettle, because they were in council and it's a big election year coming up. We'll find out what happens. What a year.
Oh, I remember.
Fabulous music, I'll tell you. You know, I remember it all. So much of it was so much fun, like Witch Doctor, you know?
Yeah.
And this was the year that they introduced basically the tango to our dance routine, because they got Patricia and Tequila, which were new forms of music for us during that year. And in at the teen canteen, we learned all kinds of bunny hops and tango. Well, not actually tango.
Only going out.
Cha-cha-cha. Yes.
What was the teen canteen?
The teen canteen was a wooden World War II Army barracks construction that was behind the auditorium on Blanding Street. It was strictly for the teenagers of the community. Every Friday night, we had teen canteen. Sometimes Saturday.
Had chaperones, you know.
Oh, chaperones. Lots of chaperones.
I don't remember because I was just 10 years old.
You were just a squirt. Yep. But great music. And the movies. What a production. Once again, some of these, like Vertigo, which is number 13 on the list, is still considered a classic. That's an Alfred Hitchcock movie. And you look at some of these others, I mean, this was kind of an odd year because a lot of the movies like Marjorie Morningstar, oh man.
I have no idea.
Marjorie Morningstar was about a woman who fell into prostitution in order to live. Yeah, it was one of those kind of movies, and she falls in with the wrong kind of people, and she ends up, the last scene, in Marjorie Morningstar, or maybe I've mixed it up with I Want to Live, but I don't think so. The last scene is her in the gas chamber.
Oh.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's really...
No one really I know was no one.
Yep, and then there was the fun stuff.
And then Cattle Knocked In.
Absolutely.
Let's take it.
Well, I don't know if that was fun stuff, but that was... That was intriguing.
South Pacific, you know.
A lot of good movies in 1958. And the very first car, the Packard Hawk. This was the last year the Packard name was produced on a car, was placed on a car. It got swallowed up along with Studebaker into the American Motors Company. This is over 58, 59.
Yeah.
Okay. And you see in the last one, the Rambler 6, that was also an American Motors car production. know, it would have been a terrific car if it just ran.
Yeah.
Also notice, yeah. Toyota Crown. It was the first production Japanese vehicle for 1958. It's interesting because after the war, Made in Japan was really a bad label to stick on anything. And so this was kind of a real venture on the Japanese, on Toyota's part, to introduce this vehicle to the American market.
If you had something that had Japanese on it, you'd be stupid.
Yep.
Yeah.
Now, this is the 59 Plymouth, but they always came out the year before, so this came out in the fall of 58, actually. Notice it's kind of swivel seat. I wish they still had them. We didn't have one.
No.
And never actually experienced it, but I think it's still a clever idea. And Plymouth was being sold by P.C. Brown Motors at that time. It says they're on South Boulevard. That's today called Ron Dare Boulevard.
Okay.
And we're going to get public housing. Lake City is moving into the big government programs, if you will.
80 units, and we're the first in the state to do that.
We are.
You know, so pretty good.
Yep. Pretty progressive in a lot of ways.
And backwards in a lot of ways, too.
I wasn't going to say that. Now, here we go. This is the year that C.B. Askins started Pre-Stress Corporation. If you see it today, you see it's a big business. It's expanded, particularly over the last couple of years under Scott. It has really become a big.
And it's called Carolina Pre-Stress.
At this point.
Yeah.
Yep. So. Science books. Oh, remember it was around 55, 56 that Sputnik went up and we started racing to the moon. And people in my generation in high school just went science crazy. Yeah, everything was about getting to the moon, the rockets. And so, as it says here, basically we ran out of science books. You know, everybody's trying to check them out, and there's not enough of them.
Yeah.
Most of the men in present were books on space missiles. That's us.
And I think, believe Miss Emily Askins was the librarian since 1930. Because when I graduated in 1966, she was still there.
She, yeah. Okay, this is Chief Moody and the Lake City Fire Department. This is 184 calls that they answered. 42 were rural. Remember that the rural fire department just started within the last year or two. Up until that, we had a city fire department. The rural fire department is by subscription. You have to pay for it.
Yeah.
There were 42 rural fire calls and an additional 17 rescue calls. Rescue calls, primarily, I bet, I don't know, but I bet they were mostly auto accidents.
Probably so.
Coward resident manufactures a highly flexible fishing line. Now, this is a story. I mean, Hubert Anderson claims that he has created a flexible bamboo cane fishing line. Kind of interesting whenever you read it. It says he has a process that makes it so flexible. He can wrap the bamboo cane around his arm. Now, look at his process. He boils the cane in vegetable oil and cures it under 6,000 degrees of temperature. Now, I'm assuming that's Fahrenheit.
Yeah.
But even if it's Fahrenheit, at that temperature, it would incinerate it.
Yeah.
They make steel at a lower temperature.
Maybe 600.
Even at 600, I would question it, but remember, he's a fisherman, and fishermen are somewhat inclined to tell tall tales. So I suspect this is another one.
Maybe so.
This is Scranton Grammar School. It got converted into a community center.
And it was where the school was, didn't it?
As I understand it, it was actually on the east side of the railroad track, about where the community center is now, in that area.
Okay.
That's my understanding. I may be wrong, but that's my understanding. Notice it's a two-story building. They had the cafeteria on the second floor, and when they turned it into a community center, they're using it primarily for the scouts, but they moved the cafeteria down to the first floor so that they could have an auditorium and a large space on the second floor.
And they would have scouts and my son called.
Room to feed 150 people. That's pretty big. Was indeed.
At the time, Mayor Pate. Okay. Was the mayor of Scranton at the time. And he was there
forever. Forever.
Yeah.
Forever.
Okay.
Okay. And this is the Presbyterian Church getting a facelift, if you will, inside. They are painting shade of green. The walls are shade of green and the woodwork is white. This is when they took that organ they've got, which is a very unique instrument, and they put it right in the center of the choir loft. So it's something to hear. You should hear it. The church committee were the people of our community that we know, like Herman Matthews, Ross Daniel, Dr. Levy King, W.A. Paula, Mr. and Mrs. Dixon, Ms. W.D. Flowers, and Ms. Pritchard. A lot of moving, hitters, heavy hitters in that
community. Oh, yeah. They were heavy hitters.
Yeah. And here is the basketball team. I'm sorry you can't read all of the names on the slide. It's a little difficult. But if I go around from the top left, which is Barbara Brown, then Sandra Wise, Linda DeBose, Ashlyn Langston, Patsy Webster, Sally McElveen, Judy Thornhill, Rosemary Tilton, Joyce Stewart, Patsy Tilton, and Betsy Duke. These were playing in the winter of 58 because Sally McElveen graduated in 58.
And also they would have the guards and the forwards. And they would pass the center line.
It was still a split court at this
time. Split court at that time. Yeah. Three guards, three forwards. That's the way it was. Now it's back and forth.
Yeah, it's no different men and women's today, but it was not that era. Okay? And this is the boys' basketball team. And run around the top, that was Herbert Timmons, that's Bruce.
So the match Turner. Number 35.
Mr. Turner's, that was Sonny Mack, that's Randy Floyd, Roger Burroughs, Danny Brake, Jimmy Rogers on the front is Robert Floyd, Leroy Moody, Johnny Mack, and Eric Hyden, and Roy Cromer, and Jerry Cooper.
You made up.
Okay. Wentworth Manufacturing came down and coming out of Massachusetts. I think he wanted to change the community because he wanted us to have more industry. So he seems to have been kind of the, Mr. Sporkin seemed to have been kind of the spark plug by the committee, trying to figure out how to get more industry in our community. Notice that Wentworth Manufacturing came in, what, 51, and they claim that they've already doubled the size of the original plant. They're now hiring between 600 and 700 people at this point.
At one point, they hired 1,000 people. And like I said, they had a population of about 500.
show. She's a very talented person. Did piano very, very well. Patsy Godwin did a baton. She was a band major, majorette, and she did a baton number for second place. And Lady Moore did a vocal solo for third place. And the club made money.
Made money off of Lansington.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was a big thing in Kingston.
Yeah.
And it's still, I think they still do.
And
in Kingston.
And they do it further south. What's Bonneau, around Bonneau, in that area.
Yeah.
Yep. And of course, you know, with Charlie Walker as the MC, it was okay, look at all these scouts. Lake City had a very active scouting organization at this point. Some of the people that you see here, you know, produced a real bumper crop. J.D. Whitehead Jr., there was Leon Whitehead, Thad Timmons, Alva Whitehead, Michael Cook, Joe Nolan, Denny Cook, Bobby Gamble, Reggie Brasington, and Jackie Singletary. All of them have gone on to much better things. But back up a moment. Point, just to point out that Collins Department Store at that point had a whole department that was devoted to Boy Scout paraphernalia.
Yeah. And craft work, I remember. Lots of craft work.
Yeah.
And the basket.
Mr. Courtney and Brasington were the scoutmasters. Okay. We told you earlier about the science thing and Sputnik, and so we weren't rocking crazy. So here we go, Lake City High School, Mr. Dicker, who loved this sort of thing, as an extra activity after school, decided he was going to have a group launch rockets. So they built them and launched them, and some got as high as 1,000 feet. Now, 1,000 feet, pretty high, particularly since they were homemade rockets. We didn't go out and buy them.
No.
Rocket engines from Estes or some of these other commercial rocket makers. Had to build them ourselves.
Yeah. 10 to 18 inches.
Yeah.
In aluminum.
At 800 feet horizontally, says it could have landed in somebody's home. Not sure that we did that, but nevertheless.
Set it out behind the school.
Did y'all make one?
Yeah.
Did you make one?
I don't recall. I recall it, but I don't recall my participation.
Walked
it out. Yep. And here it is spring, and we've got the best baseball team. And once again, you see so many, I guess it happens in all sports, all schools, that it's a core athletic group that participates in all the sports. And you'll see across the top, it's Eric Hyden, Jerry Cooper, and Johnny Mack, and then to the left is Mr. McAllister. That's Charles McAllister. We got Dick Brown. We've got Sonny Mack, and we've got Elmore Coker. And then on the next one, G.P. Broad and Leroy Moody and Byron Candy, Bruce Candy. Bruce Byron Godwin, excuse me.
Yeah.
And then on the bottom, Lloyd Cromer and Bruce Candy, Jimmy Nolan, and Russell Turner. And on the very bottom, we got Aaron Yarbrough, Wayne McCutcheon, and Randy Porter. Of course, Gene Moore was the coach at this time. Okay. Now, this is a feature of that era that probably will not be repeated, which is a real loss. But the story is apparently, I don't know whether this was for the whole United States or the state or just Lake City, but they declared a World Day of Prayer, and the merchants in Lake City closed for 1 hour on Friday from 10 to 11.
Friday, too.
Yeah.
It's a busy time.
Always.
Yeah.
There was prayer services in the churches in town during that time as well. Wow, did we make it big?
Yeah.
The Dorsey Orchestra came to town. Tommy Jimmy Dorsey Orchestra at the junior high gym. Of course, the junior high gym at that time was where the Main Street Elementary School is today. It's that same gymnasium. It was a lot less open than it is today because they literally built bleachers, wooden bleachers, on both sides of the court, the basketball court, with a big wall, you know, that separated the court from the audience at that time. So it was still a pretty big place for dancing.
Yeah.
Sponsored by WJOT.
Also from 8 to midnight, damn, that's late for those folks.
Yeah, it was late because it was a Monday night.
Yeah.
So
go back to work on Tuesday.
I'm quite sure that's one of the reasons I didn't go. But
yeah,
that and the fact that I can't dance, you know.
Yeah, probably. The Baptist didn't go either.
Small crowd.
All right, let's go to the next slide.
Okay. Oh, Wanda Humphreys, Lake City Girl, won the Oratoga contest. Beauty and brains both.
Yeah.
I tell you, it's always a marvelous combination. She won the Oratoga contest. Americanism Committee of the American Legion sponsored it. And you have to talk on the Constitution of the United States for 10 to 12 minutes. How do you get that precise?
I don't know.
I don't either. Second place, Steve McMillan, honorable mention, Ethel May Parker, judged by Mrs. Ed Bowen, Ms. Lewis Flanagan, and Mrs. R.L. Cotton. Oh, they didn't give it. They didn't give you anything. You earned it.
All right, so we still got the science.
Okay. Still on science. Science fair that we had. So, 7th, 8th, and 9th grade.
Was all the same.
Yeah. I really would have loved to see that first exhibit, Bird Wing.
Yeah.
Of South Carolina.
Yeah, Eddie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have to get him to explain what he did.
Sammy Huggins is in the
Second place, the Sea Life by Norma Carter. And third place, Diorama of Prehistoric Times by Kate Gottschall and Cornelia Webster. Eighth grade, Mount Harvard Observatory. Where is Mount Harvard? I don't either. Connie McClendon and Nancy Tripp got second. Okay. Mount Palomar.
Yeah.
Lynn Brown and Marriott Stavose. And third was Model of an Arm by Hayward Hutchinson and David Matthews. Ninth grade, we're getting into space. Space Travel by William Newton Leon Whitehead. We're back to Earth for second place. Feeding chicks for proper growth. Carolyn Kennedy and Jerome Burrs. Third was coin collection. I hope either Benny or W.E. Hoover has still got that collection. You know, it might actually be worth something. In high school, the first place was a three-stage rocket by Amy McKenzie. These people were studying stuff I missed. Second place on mitosis. I'm still not sure I know what that is. I bet she did. And the third was Judy Bell doing the digestive system. Okay? Oh, yeah. Outstanding citizens. These are being nominated and chosen by the Junior Chamber of Commerce. Miss Ruby Smith deserted.
Yeah.
She was a marvel. She's a music teacher in Lake City for a long time. Then she became the minister of music, not minister of music, but director of music for the Baptist Church. She was my choir director when I joined in 9th grade. It's amazing she let me do it. But
I was in there too. So.
Miss Ruby was very demanding. I tell you everybody, my sister was a good pianist. Miss Ruby taught her, and because because Claire could play well. She took me as a student, and after about 2 months, she suggested I find another teacher.
Yeah.
Mr. Cockfield.
Yeah.
This was before I became Dr. Cockfield. Mr. Cockfield was principal at the junior high school at this point.
You told me. Interpreted. I didn't know that.
I didn't know that either.
In 58.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So gotta start somewhere.
In 59.
Came here.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So.
And Mr. Ruby Smith was a resident of Lake City since 1918.
Mr. Ruby Smith is just another little note. Her father was the preacher. Got called to the Baptist church, and he brought his whole family. Miss Ruby was the only one that stayed when he moved on.
Right.
Took his next.
And people with mortgages on homes to build that church.
Yes. Okay. Whoa, you're going through them in a hurry.
Yeah.
Class of 1958. We got
a couple of folks we know.
Oh, yeah. On this one, in case you can't read it, I don't know, at the bottom is Janice Brown, Glenda Button, Gordon Candy, James Irvin Burge, Elmore Coker, and Marietta Cockfield. And on the next one, once again, to read them on the bottom, in case it gets cut off, it's Polly Jo Eady, Geneva Floyd, Jimmy Elch, Robert Floyd, Jackie Fryer, and Russell Gaskins. And here, once again, reading the bottom ones, is Ron Langley, W.S. Lowder, Merwin Lowder, George Lyerly, James Lynch, and Tina McCutcheon. And once again, the bottom is Ivan Morris, Annie Lou Morris, Jimmy Nolan, Ethel May Parker, Dottie Norwood, and Maxie Poston. Okay. On the bottom we have Sylvia Ward, Patty Whitlock, Mary Yarbrough, Dolores Cox.
That's the class of 1958.
And it brings back so many memories. The canteen would actually teach you to dance. People like me that did no good. But we had quite a few people that were that were great dancers. Ms. Hybert Bell and Ms. Herbert Rollins offered lessons to teens on Friday nights, two Friday nights a month, and from 7 to 10. Had to be a member, cost 50 cents for the year. Oh, what a tale. We almost were an international city.
Yeah.
With international visitors. We had, Hep Palmer was a local radio host, did the sports, thought of himself as a fisherman, talked about it, bragged on it. So somebody called his bluff.
Yeah.
Called him on it. So he had to have a fishing contest. Well, he invited a Russian from the embassy in Washington to come and participate.
But the State Department
wouldn't let him.
Wouldn't let him.
That was, once again, we're still Cold War. I mean, you know,
they were still Cold War.
Yeah, exactly. So, didn't want to let him in on our agricultural secrets at the time. So. Wouldn't let them come.
And the pond was at Pine Bay.
Pine Bay.
Big pond at Pine Bay. There, which is next door to Dunport.
Yeah. Now, if you read underneath the newspaper article, you'll see that Hap didn't win. Showing off his big catch. You know, that's Ann Woodson. high school student with him. And
she married to Kelly.
Gene Kelly?
Gene Kelly. George Kelly's brother.
Oh, okay.
And Kelly and all sister moms.
Okay. Safety patrol. This is a big thing in our era.
I'm going to be safety patrol someday.
I think I got to be a substitute for one or something.
I got to be one time.
Yeah, I just love putting on that strap and the badge on it, standing in the corner, pointing at people, stopping cars. It was great. But you can see, obviously, they played favorites. Because look at these people. I mean, were they better than you and me? I don't think so.
Not sicko.
Yeah.
And Gary Daniels.
Was he on there?
He's on there, yeah.
Yeah, look at that.
Yeah. Yeah. My cousin. Yeah.
School Safety Patrol Boy of the Year, Kenneth Bowen.
Yeah, man, he deserved it.
He'd probably still be in there. Was he patrol? School patrol. Got a certificate from Mr. Gradley in front of everybody in the auditorium. Oh, actually, it says that he was voted on by the other patrol members.
Would y'all?
What would you have to do to get Safety Patrol Boy of the Year?
No clue.
No.
No idea how you got selected.
You just stopped.
Somebody just said you want it?
Yeah.
You know, yeah. I expect, but
we don't really know.
I'm sure it was the teacher and the principal cabal that decided these things. It was not by open vote.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Not Democratic. This was a terrific thing R.L. Cockfield and Mr. Gradley did for several years, Western tours. And you can see all the kids that went with them.
I have to confess, that's a picture, 1959.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
59. But then, come on, this is the crew of 58.
Okay.
Couldn't win. The origin was that Rima King didn't have a chance to go out west. I was turned down by a group. And Mr. Darrell, his nephew, Mr. Darrell said, "We'll bring each of your couple friends up and we'll go out west." So that's how I got started.
And Rima was a popular boy, so he got lots of friends.
Yes, they took off and went west.
And it became an institution for quite a few years.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, the ball field they're talking about here is by the new high school.
Right.
Okay. And so it's kind of between the school and the football stadium. There's a corner there on Carlisle Street where they did this. And they put in lighting. I find it interesting that this is the first time they really thought about softball games. So I believe, if I'm not mistaken, in that era, only the girls played softball.
Yeah, probably.
So they are now setting it up so that they can play baseball and softball in the evenings.
Yeah, you know who hit the first home run? A guy named Arthur Parker.
Really?
Yeah. I was there that day. And he pulled it. I mean, he popped it good.
Oh, my.
Yeah, but he the first one.
Arthur Parker.
Arthur Parker. Had a baseball over there at Jay Bunn.
With
his name on it in the year.
I'll be there in the trophy case.
So,
yeah. Here we go. Wanda Humphreys. Miss Lake City, runners up Miss Betty Jo Thigpen, second Isabel Graham, boat run. That's basically crab. Yeah, the gravy ship.
Steve Allen.
Okay.
I think so.
Yeah.
Johnny Dance.
Now, this is going to have implications on the political structure of Lake City. You just watch. Okay, the Johnny tax. It was 50 cents for the first load in your home and 25 cents ever after. Now, I don't think they actually send somebody around the camera.
No, I don't. I think it was an honor system.
Yeah, well.
I mean, yeah.
Like it says, the one housewife has three commodes and complained that the dollar tax is unfair, you know, in her case. Don't use but one, she said.
And then you got $1 for 10 people.
Yeah, right. So that's 10 cents a person. Yeah. Says George Tommy said the commode tax is gaining acceptance. Some people are even calling in to report they have more than one. But as he says, they just brag. Okay, Lake City gets its second funeral home in 1958.
It's James Bryce.
And Mr. Bert Thomas.
Bert Thomas, yeah.
Yep. And this is the house. It was
Moultrie Epps'
home on Main Street.
No,
Church Street. Excuse me.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's where Tammy Godfrey's place is.
Yes, and it was right across the street from Bowen Big Brick Warehouse at the time.
On Salt Street.
Yep. Yeah. So Mr. Price was the driver in this. He'd been with Epps Funeral Home for 7 years before this. Rollins Epps had died just recently. And so he and Mrs. Epps left. Mrs. Epps was a licensed funeral director and a lady attendant. He was an embalmer. And so Bert Thomas, between them, they opened the new funeral home. Now, I find the last line interesting. Next to the last line, it says that they have a Cadillac straight ambulance fully equipped and with oxygen. I have to admit, my first thought was a funeral home with an oxygen tank, you know. I mean, they're a little anxious. But then I realized they actually created the first ambulance service in Lake City. But the original Rollins Epps funeral home on Thomas Street was sold to Kiel's Brockington. And Mr. Brockington had been in Lake City also for the last 7 years. And he was joined by Roy Rogers and Leslie McCutcheon. And Mrs. Brockington and Mrs. Rogers were the lady attendants for the funeral home. Okay. 23 good reasons for tobacco selling higher in Lake City. You can see 10 warehouses, 4 buy sets of buyers, and 9 buying purchasing companies, as they call it.
Lake City was in a heyday.
I guarantee you.
Yeah.
Yeah. It shows 900
square feet.
900,000 square feet. Had a lot of space. If we weren't the biggest mullet, we were always buying with mullets to sell the most tobacco in South Carolina.
I remember they would take the trucks down Thomas Street and we would put brick bags.
Hoping truck would bump at something, get spilled.
The bump.
Yeah, get a bump.
And then said.
I have to sell it back to him. Best firefighting unit in the state was in Lake City. Our rural fire department, which was, once again, fairly new, is the largest and best equipped in South Carolina. Says, they have, in just a couple of years, gone from 300 members to 800 members. These are subscribers to the Rural Fire Protection Service. The field insurance rates will be reduced by 50%, they fell.
They went from man to dog.
Yep.
Then F&M gates.
I mean, then wide open. That's a huge area.
Lower Florence County and up in Williamsburg County.
Yep. Had to keep some of that fire equipment at Chief Moody's house because they had so much. And here is a 1958 football team. Yours truly played that year. Yeah. Fine looking bunch of young men. Fine.
This was the year before Lexington High School football team won the conference.
Yep. We did real well this year, but they did much better next year. Of course, next year I wouldn't play.
They were undefeated.
I don't think that. Yeah, I don't think that's the reason they went undefeated.
Good.
Okay. Oh, Mr. Keith, A.C. Keith Jr. and his family went traveling up to North Carolina and Cherokee. Can you imagine putting yourself in his position, he and his family get out to see an exhibit?
And his car's going rolling.
Rolling, rolling, rolling.
And you can't stop.
And off the cliff. 250 feet drop. Total loss. Oh, they got all this stuff, but
it took a bus on my babies. I mean, I know that those old folks would have gave them a fit.
Oh, you know that they gave them a fit.
Do
you have a story to tell, though?
Yeah.
Open house. This is Brockington Epps on Thomas Street. They gonna describe the quality of merchandise sold by their firm. So they're gonna have people who sell caskets, and I don't think they had urns back then because cremation wasn't popular, but I can't imagine whatever other funeral supplies they were selling. I didn't go, I was not
there. Go in there and go in with a bow.
Yeah, he would. Our father was a barber, and he was frequently called to cut the hair of corpses, to shave them, and things like that.
Yeah.
Now, as a result, we now got another dedication at the Price and Thomas Funeral Home. Yep.
In competition, Chuck Coons.
Now it says there's a portrait of Mr. Epps, I'm sure that's Rollins Epps, was done by Mr. Richard Benner. Yeah. Mr. Benner was a Germanist, I believe.
Right, yeah.
Moved to Lake City. He was one of those really talented, multi-talented people. He did all kinds of
workshop in his backyard.
Yep.
And we called him Pop Pop.
Pop Pop.
And he would have a little workshop behind Presbyterian Church, and every Saturday morning, frequently, he would open up the workshop and we would cut out different things, you know, and paint it.
Yeah, and, woodworking, he also did metal machinery and machining and things like that.
Poetry and painting.
He was a very good painter.
And also, he had primary. And frame job.
Didn't you tell me that picture of Ronald Zips is still around, still hanging somewhere?
It's so that Tammy got his life.
Oh, okay. Good. Here we go. We're turning the rascals out. Tax my commode. Don't get my vote. Poor Willie, he's gone. We elected an alternate slate. Some of them got held over.
Yeah.
You know, C.J. Evans won mayor, but city council, Ed Bowen, Boyd Nettles, Ed Roper, J.H. Cockfield, and George Tommy.
And Mr. Clifford was called Big Daddy.
Notice that Ms. Alice Gary ran, and she received 259 votes. It's the first election we know of that a woman ran for public office in Lake City.
And she was a big Republican. Ooh, she was a big Republican.
Okay.
Football team.
We were football crazy in a lot of ways. I was one of the coaches. Leo Harrell and I were coaches of two might teams. These kids were all 10 and under, as I recall, and they were the Mighty Mites.
And they had the football field behind there when we went to school.
Yep, over on Landing Street.
Yeah.
And we had practice on alternate days, so they didn't steal our secret plays.
I think Leo, they practiced over there.
I know we practice off of Landing Street, but
yeah, I think they practice over at the high school.
It was exciting football.
Yeah.
Oh, they Sam White, Billy Budden were great dancers.
Yeah.
Great dancers. They won the contest at WBTW-TV in Florence.
And it was a big thing to be on TV.
It was. It was. They got a trophy and some music albums. The runners up were also Gene Brown and Ben Tommy.
Yeah, yeah.
Great dancers. Judy Bell Reggie Brasington. I don't know about Reggie. Yeah, Judy was pretty good. I don't know. But both, they're all given albums.
Yeah.
PC Brown Motors got destroyed by fire. Now this is at 2 p.m. on Friday. That's interesting. We'll come back to it in a moment. But $150,000 partially covered by insurance. Because Wilbur Brown was running it at that point.
It was right there on 52.
Yeah.
Right, I think right at the corner of 52 and Main Street.
Honestly, I don't remember exactly where it was.
San Jose is one
of the things. Well, that was Brown property on that corner, yes, I know that.
Sandy Cove.
Yep. Lake City had a giant parade.
Oh, yeah.
Unfortunately, there were impediments. It was not as big as planned. Two major events. It snowed. Mind you, never snowed at Lake City. 1958, it snowed. How much did it snow? I remember at the new high school, we went out, we were dismissed because it was too dangerous for the buses to drive. And so the kids in town went to school only to be dismissed early. And so we went out into the front yard of the high school there and tried to make a snowman. And as I recall, the snowman was about that tall. Not much snow, but it was enough that the streets were dangerous. It's not just the snow, it's the ice as well.
Sand and rock salt.
Yep. And most of the out-of-town parades and floats chose not to come. Didn't have bands. So we did have King Street High School showed up, and Andrew's float showed up. Everybody else kind of canceled out, but all the locals, the Lake City Band, marched in it. But notice that the fire, remember PC Motors, this is the same time PC Motors is burning. And so we had the parade got held up. And we had a lot of the units, fire department units that normally participate in parade couldn't because they were fighting a fire. There were floats and prizes. First place, Lake City Methodist Church. Second, Dixie Canteen. And apparently split with Eagles trying to die.
And then the bicycle club. Bicycle contest.
Toby Dudes. Jimmy Rose got second. Jesse Gaines third. All right. And here we have the inauguration ceremony for our local officials. C.J. Evans. Now notice Mr. Cook may have lost the race, but he didn't lose his place, so to speak. He got elected as the city building inspector, or selected, because I'm pretty sure it was the city council that selected him. It's interesting how, go back one moment if you would, it's interesting that in that time, that city council members were responsible for specific aspects of city governance. So, W.B. Nettles was responsible for administration. East Ed Bowen for streets, George Tommy for water, Dr. Cotfield for health, Jack Trullo for the police, and Ed Roper for fire. Van Epps was reappointed to the Board of Health, and Ernest Moore to the Lake City Housing Commission.
Okay.
So, that was 1958, one heck of a year. I enjoyed it thoroughly. I hope you did too.
Yeah. And we'll discuss 1959 in February the 28th.
All right. See you then.
See you then.